A warm welcome back. We will now proceed to panel 2, titled Regional Relevance of the BRI. I would like to introduce our distinguished panelists who are on stage. First, Professor Dai Yonghong, Director, Center for Myanmar Studies, Institute of South Asian Studies, School of International Studies, Sichuan University, China. Next, Dr. Xu Gong, Research Fellow at the S. Rajaratnam School of International Studies, Nanyang Technological University, Singapore. Next, Mr. Luxman Siriwardena, Executive Director and Director, China Sri Lanka Center, Pathfinder Foundation, Sri Lanka. And Mr. Johan Burger, Director, NTU-SBF Center for African Studies, Nanyang Business School, Singapore. This session will be chaired by Admiral Dr. Jayanath, Director, Center for Indo-Lanka Initiatives at the Pathfinder Foundation, Sri Lanka. I now hand over the session to Dr. Colombage.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon, everybody. I think it's a tough task now after the sumptuous lunch by courtesy ISAS. So we need to keep our eyes and ears open. But I'm sure the panel that I have will definitely keep you awake and share their thoughts on a very specific topic now. In the morning, we had a great speech from the minister, and also the session, very interactive session. So now we move on to talk about the regional relevance of the BRI. In fact, some of the issues were raised during the earlier sessions, and I would pose few questions to the panel right at the beginning, and also to the audience. And basically, I will start with how do countries along the BRI feel about it? I think that's one question we need to find answers. Do they see BRI as an opportunity or as a threat? So is China is going to be the new regional leader through the BRI? How the power structure at Asia Pacific is going to change? And is China the new leader in globalization and also with environment? And also is China promoting world peace through the BRI and through common development? And what should be the contribution from the states to BRI? Now, BRI cannot be a top-down concept. It has to be a contribution from the down-up as well. And also, what are the arguments against BRI? I think some we heard. So how do we address that? I mean, whether it is an economic project, or whether it is linked to strategic infrastructure, or whether it is linked to the resources. So how do we see that? And then also some idea about what are the similar initiatives like Asia-Africa Growth Corridor, Sagarmala, Neighborhood First, and Sagar, the Indian conceptions, and how these policies combine to the betterment of Indo-Pacific region. Is there an alternative for BRI? If we do not want to accept BRI, then what is the alternative and who is capable of delivering it? So these are some of the questions I believe will transpire to you in the next session. And I was given very strict orders to stick to the timing, so I kindly request all the panelists to stick to their 20-minute timing, and then we'll come to the question and answer session. So I have the great honor to introduce or request my friend Professor Dai Yonghong to start your presentation. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. It's my great honor to be here, and first I would like to thank you very much, Mr. Chairperson, and also the co-sponsors of this NUS of Singapore, and also the Pathfinder for inviting me to share my understanding of this China why I choose this topic is primarily because that that 4 years ago, Chinese President proposed this BRI during his visit to Kazakhstan and also to Indonesia in September and October of 2013, respectively. This BRI was formulated. Since then, this initiative has gradually become an international consensus, and also it has become international actions. And as I said in the morning, it will become international benefits. At the end of the day, maybe 5 years or 10 years or even 2 decades later, because this initiative has been put into the constitution of Chinese government. And so within this, under this BRI framework, we know that there are practical action plans, so which has put the top priority on these five connectivities. Among these five connectivities, three of them are closely related to the infrastructure contents. The first is, of course, the policy connectivity. Second is the infrastructure connectivity. And the third is trade facilitation or trade connectivity. And the fourth one is financial integration. And the last one is people-to-people bond. Under this framework, we have the six economic corridors. Either it is bilateral ones such as CPEC, China-Pakistan Economic. CPEC, China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, or some multilateral mechanism, for example, the BCIM, Bangladesh, China, India, and Myanmar. And also we have some other multilateral economic corridors such as the China, Russia, Mongolia, China, Central Asia, China, the Indo-China, Southeast Asia. But for the past 4 years, even though substantial progress has been made in these bilateral or multilateral connectivities with our neighboring countries, but we still find that some challenges still ahead of us. So in November of last year, that is November 19, 2017, Chinese President Xi Jinping paid a visit to Laos, a member of the ASEAN member. So both China and the Laos government agreed to establish a bilateral economic corridor, which is the first corridor of this kind to build it in the new terms or in the sense of the new context. And during the visit by Chinese Foreign Minister Wang Yi's visit to Myanmar, Wang Yi also proposed the second of this kind of economic corridor with the Myanmar government. So I will focus on this. I will focus on this topic. China. China-Myanmar tri-pillar economic corridor under BRI. To see what are the main strengths and weakness and opportunities and threats facing this China-Myanmar economic corridor. Because every initiative has to be project driven, and all every project should be driven bilaterally and specifically. Yeah. If we look back to the historical lessons or experiences of both China and Myanmar in its economic development,
I use this
special method, analytical method to do this. Yeah, first the SWOT method to see what are the strengths of facing Myanmar. We know that ever since its independence in 1947, Myanmar has tried very hard to build a beautiful country, of course, at the very beginning, right after the Second World War. Myanmar was one of the best country with great potential in Southeast Asia, as Sri Lanka was, especially right after the Second World War. And actually, Myanmar has possessed many of the advantages. First is the regional advantages, because it's a meeting place between the South Asia and Southeast Asia, and it's also is the meeting place between these two rising powers, China and India. But unfortunately, they have some weaknesses. The first point is that Myanmar's disadvantage is the poor governance, national governance, and as well as this Western countries' misunderstanding either in 1950s or in 1980s, right after the 1980 with the Western sanctions imposed by the US-led Western countries, right? And of course, they have some national policies, but due to this poor implementation of the good governance, so Myanmar still remained one of the most the least developed countries in the world. So that is from the 2007, there is a transition period, either in political transition or economic transition or social transition. The three areas have made substantial progress for the past 7 years. But at the same time, that China, as I told you, as I said in the morning, that China has three obvious advantages for the neighboring countries. The first advantage that China can provide to the neighboring countries is the capital advantage. Second is the technologies. And the third is the management. Because we know that ever since 1978, when China adopted the policy of economic reform and opened to the outside world, China learned a lot from the Western countries. To be frank, speaking with you, because I said that China learned the successful experiences of Singapore, as well as the successful experiences of the South Korea and even our Hong Kong and Taiwan, because we first opened to this mainland, our coastal areas to Taiwan, Macau, and also at the very beginning we opened to Singapore, opened to Japan, and we also opened further to France and Germany. These two Western countries, because our former leader Deng Xiaoping has one famous saying that whatever, whether it is black cat or the white cat, to develop is the top priority. Those who can catch the mouse is the most successful the cat, right? And we don't have experience at the very beginning, so we have to implement many experimental in economic development, and fortunately speaking, for the past 35 years, now this year is 40 years anniversary of Chinese opening door policy to the world. I think that from the by the year of 2010, China has become the second largest economy. So we should say that China is in the position to provide what our neighboring countries need urgently, that is capital advantage, technologies, and management, especially particularly in the area of infrastructure. So when people ask me what are the key successful factors in Chinese success over the past 40 years, I will definitely tell them that we have the most successful ruling party, which can mobilize the national comprehensive resources to focus our national agenda of economic development. That is the most successful ruling party and the longest ruling party, which secured the success of Chinese the PRI and Chinese people to get the benefits. So for this, what the Myanmar government did can be provided by Chinese government. That is capital, technologies, and management. So opportunities right now, I think the BRI is an opportunity for China, not only for China, but also for the neighboring countries, even for the countries in the far European countries, especially the Central and the Eastern European countries. The 16 plus 1 mechanism managed you very well, especially for the past few years. Even the most advanced European, Western European countries, for example, France, Germany, they are very active in participating in Chinese proposed BRI, especially they have become a member of the AIIB. Just not only the neighboring countries, but also the some most developed countries. Yeah, this is the opportunities. Then how about the Myanmar, China-Myanmar Economic Corridor, and according to the official plan of Chinese government initiated by Chinese Foreign Minister Wang Yi, this trilateral or this bilateral economic corridor actually is looks like a tri-pillar, is a tri-pillar. Running from the north, running from the Kunming in the north to the center of Myanmar, Mandalay, the central city, the cultural center of historical center of Myanmar, and running to the southwest to the Yangon, new city of Yangon, and also to the southwest of Piaopiao. So it looks like just a tri-pillar, just like this. Yeah. Here, I have a picture for this. So this is the first phase one construction. That is the first running from Kunming in China's Yunnan province and going down to the border areas between China and Myanmar and then to the Mandalay, and from Mandalay they extended west, southwest to Piaopiao and southeast to Yangon. But my personal opinion is that Chinese government is only the beginning for this China-Myanmar Economic Corridor. We may have phase one, that is further, the second phase of this CMEC. We can start from Piaopiao westward to reach as far as to the Dhaka, Bangladesh. And from the Yangon city, we can extend southward to Dawei of Myanmar, very close to Singapore. Because in the morning, I think Minister of Sim Ang, she mentions a very important plan for Singapore in the next 10 years. Because before I came here, I met the Consul General to Chengdu of Singapore government. He explained the same idea as Simon said, this CCI, the South Transportation Corridor established between China and Singapore, because Singapore government has so far has two very successful models of cooperation, bilateral cooperation between China and Singapore. The first one is in Suzhou Industrial Park. The second one is the Echo Park in Tianjin, China's second largest municipality. And the third one is in Chongqing, this CCI. The CCI mainly focuses on this aviation, logistic, and infrastructure, especially trying to connect Chongqing with Chengdu and also Xi'an, the capital city of Shaanxi province, the hometown of President Xi Jinping. Because I think they have a plan just to extend this logistic hub from China's western part to the downward, southward, to include Yunnan and also Guangxi, and try to connect together with the maritime Silk Road from the Beibu one, yeah, the Bay of Beibu, very close to Guangxi and Vietnam. So this is the second phase, because this is a further extension of the first stage. So not only between China and Myanmar, but also between China, Myanmar, and Bangladesh, maybe to the east, to the southeast, we can include Thailand, because there are three economic special economic zones in Myanmar. The first one is Tilawadi, together with between Myanmar and Japan. Second one is Kiao Kiao economic special economic zone between China and Myanmar. The third one is Dai Yonghong special economic zone between Myanmar and Thailand and some Italian government. But so far as I know, that the Myanmar government is to pay all the more attention to this Dai, because they think that maybe maritime economy is their next priority for future development. Not necessarily connect, of course, the first step is connected with China, but the second step is just connected from Yangon to southward, southeastward to reach Dawei. Yeah, I can explain these two. What are the benefits that this CMEC can bring about to both Myanmar and China? Of course, we know that win-win goal of this BRI is the final goal. There are somebody that very skeptical about China's win-win strategy, saying that, okay, China trying to dominate this investment. And even some scholars ask me the very similar question that, okay, since China is the second largest economy, and you have so much investment in your neighboring countries and throughout the world. How many minutes? Okay, so I will try to finish it. Okay. Okay. I just make it simple. Okay. So the final goal is just the win-win. Of course, in this process, we have. I can show you. The first is industrial clustering for Myanmar. Because it's from Kunming to Mandalay and to Yangon and to Kiao, there are great potentials for this industrial clustering effects. Because out of this CMEC, many industrial parks can be created by the strong support, financial support from China. And you have the huge demands for these building materials and including cement and this is from the infrastructure building, the industrial clustering. And the second one is the central city clustering, because we know that Yangon is the relatively developed region of Myanmar, while Mandalay and Kiao Kiao is the relatively poor developed countries, least developed countries. By integrating in Myanmar's national agenda to Chinese BRI, this area, the poor areas, can be upgraded to the richer or relatively affluent regions. So this is the center clustering impacts. And finally, of all this, we know that ever since Aung San Suu Kyi's NLD government took power, three key challenges facing Myanmar. The first is the political transition, which I think is very successful. Now, an early government is a civilian elected government, which is absolutely okay for China. As we said, that China has adopted a policy of non-interference to domestic affairs of any neighboring countries, because this is the choice of our neighboring country people's choice. So, and the third challenge is the people's living standards, how to improve the developing economy. I think that this is the top priority currently. And the third one is the ethnic, the national reconciliation. The three challenges facing the new government, there is no any order of priority, maybe because a certain development can secure peace, and peace can further promote development. So facing this tough economic development agenda in Myanmar, the NRP government needs capital, technologies, and management most, right? Because only can the Myanmar government develop its economy, can the peace negotiation or peace reconciliation can be realized at the end of the day. And even this, David, look at this. I think the Rohingya issue, I would like to mention one more point. Because many Western countries are now severely criticized that Aung San Suu Kyi's NRP government not doing well in this Rohingya issue. And so China has made its proposal to settle down this, to get a permanent resolution to this tough question. The first of this kind of solution put forward by a member of the permanent member of the UN Security Council, that is first ceasefire and then sit down and negotiate. And finally, we need to develop these poor regions. If we can integrate the KLPO together with Dhaka, Bangladesh, then that will be the final solution to this. Because poverty can create terrorists, can create terror. Right. Okay, sorry, due to this limited time. Thank you very much. Sorry.
Thank you very much, Professor, for this very illuminating presentation on the potential of DRI and its special references to Myanmar. And now I will invite Dr. Gong Xue to talk about ASEAN and DRI.
Thank you. Before the laptop is handed over here, first of all, I'd like to thank Institute of Southeast Asian Studies and Pathfinder for having me here. It's a great honor to have this sort of connectivity, to meet with new people, to meet with old friends. So what I'm going to talk about today is the prospects of China's BRI in Southeast Asia. Everybody talks about it. Some people criticize it, some people praise it. Well, what I would like to think is to use the figures to demonstrate how BRI is actually ongoing in Southeast Asia. So this is actually part of my academic project. I assess the progress, development, and also the challenges of BRI, but only narrowly in Southeast Asia. I have several arguments, but for today's presentation, I only have like three. First, we argue BRI will reactivate the existing mechanisms, which kind of like inactive, and also tries to reiterate the regional, economy and the global uncertainty. And then, the idea of BRI actually plays a role of wake up call to other external region, to other external powers such as Japan and such as India. So with those mechanisms on the ground, Southeast Asian countries can actually reap the benefits of alternative options. So the slides may be a little bit, the font is kind of small, but what I try to say here is those are the economic cooperation zones actually were conducted or started prior to BRI response. For example, the Sinohung Special Economic Zone in Cambodia, for example, the Potang Mohang Economic Zone in Laos, which was started in 2010. So actually, before the BRI, there were a lot of things ongoing. So what I want to say here is ASEAN countries are not, BRI is not as a major attraction to other regions such as Central Asia or South Asia. China has long dealings with Southeast Asian countries, and those economic activities has been institutionalized through, for example, the CAFTA, the trade agreement. Because of those foundations, China and ASEAN countries, they have sort of really like concrete progress. And here on the ground, the synergy between China's BRI and the Southeast Asian countries are conducted, as I raised in the morning session, bilaterally. So there are several projects like China-Myanmar gas and oil pipelines, but of course they were initiated much further than BRI was born. But you can see there are newly initiated projects such as Malaysia East Coast Railway Link, such as the Malacca Gateway. With all those things ongoing, you see the both sides are kind of like receiving sort of benefits, which I wanted to show in here, which I cannot see clearly. I mean. So the figure shows ASEAN member states actually becomes the third largest investor in China. So it updated to December 2017. It is the latest figure I can find out. So which means ASEAN countries reap the benefits of investing opportunities in mainland China itself. And this figure shows from 2013 to 2016, you can see there's a huge hike in 2015, if I'm not, 2015, the figure from Chinese investments to Southeast Asian countries actually doubled, although it kind of like declined in 2016, but it is subject to the, international economy. So here is the interesting findings that I find out in the areas where China invested most. You see that traditionally people would think China invests largely on energy, on mining, on kind of like logistics infrastructure. But what I find out is the figures from 2013 when BRI was introduced, the concentrated sector actually is on leasing and commercial services, particularly in 2015 with the figure of, I couldn't see, you can see that. But what I can tell you that the growth rate is from 2013 to 2015, China's commercial services in Southeast Asia actually grow 310%. So which is really, really surprising. While the second comes is the manufacturing. The growth rate actually increased by 180%. Well, of course, there are growth, in like the traditional sector China was interested, like energy, but the growth rate is roughly 50%. So what I find out here is the tertiary industry where China invested, it accounted for 51%, which is kind of like, out of expectations. Of course, there were promises, there were positive sides, there are definitely going to be concerns of China's involvement in this region. The conventional or the common sense, the common concerns, focused on the growing trading balance, for example, the centrality of ASEAN, or even in the conflicting South China Sea issues. But what I try to emphasize here is China's own ability of delivering. There are challenges China's domestic institutions. People think that after 19th Party Congress, President Xi Jinping can consolidate his power, which I don't have any issues with that. But the thing is, on the ground, China still lacks the inter-organizational, the coordination amongst all initiatives. For example, the Indo-China Peninsula Economic Corridor, how it is synergized with the so-called the infrastructure connectivity projects in the Lanka-Mekong Corporation. I know there are different initiatives. People may question. Maybe they just there's not such necessity of synergizing them. But which in my mind, the geographically they overlap a lot. Well, just now the Professor Dai Yonghong mentioned about the tri-pillar economic corridor, also about China Laos bilateral economic corridor. The mechanisms there existed for a decade. So how to synergize those initiatives in order to prevent chaotic competition inside of China, either among the local governments or among central or provincial state-owned enterprises. It is a big question for China to handle. And of course, people were talking about the sustainability of China's BRI, which in my mind, it is actually progressing. We hear a lot of complaints about China's dam projects, investments in the Mekong sub-region, which I conducted a field trips last year. Of course, there are still problems, but you can see there is a rising awareness of the corporate social responsibilities. But how to what extent it can be different from the previous going out campaign? It is subject to the implementation and the supervision of the Chinese government. And I also cover, China's made progress. Also, it is acknowledging the important part of, the soft part, like people-to-people connections. But Southeast Asia is different in terms of its ethnic Chinese, how the government treats the ethnic Chinese here, what kind of role they should be played, and it remains kind of like a rising concern. So other than that, also China still lacks kind of experiences of dealing with international NGOs. So there's already records for them to show the improvement. But what I want to emphasize here that the Chinese government needs to show the transparency issue along the Belt and Road Initiative so that the concerns can be reduced. So here's the wake up call or part, which I think a lot of people addressed this morning about how the geopolitical concerns can be taken into this region, like how India, how Japan was kind of also reactivate their initiatives. For example, India openly refused to participate in BRI, but what I think the BCIM economic corridor is groovy because of the political mistrust, because of the recent military standoffs in Vietnam. And also, that last year, the four countries, including India, resumed the Quad dialogue, emphasizing regional connectivity. So there are existing or ongoing, the connected or infrastructure projects that India has been proposing or has been conducting. And people were talking about the Asia-Africa Growth Corridor, etc. I'm not going to cover that. I think most of you already know this. What I try to emphasize here is the road and the land connectivity from Sichuan to northeast of India, which is kind of like supported by Japan, but I'm going to cover later. This is the Mekong-India Economic Corridor, and this is the trilateral highway project by India. Here comes the Japan, which is sophisticatedly investing here in Southeast Asia, whose economic influence is much, much more profound. The map you can see clearly, Japan is actively involved in air, in maritime, in land. For example, it tries to synergize with ASEAN's role and role of projects, trying to help the small port, trying to help with the developing the small ports to reduce the logistic time. which China is also trying to do that. But because of BRI, BRI plays a catalytic effect that forces Japan to change its investment strategy. For example, I think in 2015, Japan, the Japanese government amended the lending through the Japan Bank of International Cooperation to encourage its Japanese companies to take further risks in order to compete with China. So you can see those several comparisons. The most prominent one is the China-Japan competition for building the Jakarta-Bandung Railway and Japan's partnership for quality infrastructure, highlighting the quality and also increasing the lending of AEB vis-a-vis the AIIB. And when it comes to the Mekong region, Japan's new Tokyo strategy 2015 for Mekong-Japan cooperation vis-a-vis China's Nanyang Mekong cooperation. The United States, it has never been a very large infrastructure player in this region, but of course it challenges China's influence through different ways. I think experts on the security side has more knowledge than me. If you come to the sort of like infrastructure, I'm sure definitely you know the Lower Mekong Initiative, which emphasizes the soft part, like the capacity building, like institutional cooperation, etc. Of course, last year, President Donald Trump issued this national security strategy, trying to reassert the American role in this region. So how China is going to react towards that. And there's also possibility of reviving the new Silk Road by the United States and on how to cooperate with its partners in this region in terms of Indo-Pacific Economic Corridor. So does that mean, I mean, for all those three countries I mentioned here, does that mean more opportunities or more alternatives or more dilemmas for Southeast Asian countries? So my conclusion is, for the current stage, the BRI would be implemented through bilateral or sub-regional level. Although, you know, at the regional level, there's kind of like a rhetoric synergizing commitment, but I didn't see any concrete projects launched at the regional level. But if I'm wrong, you're welcome to correct me. And also, ASEAN countries will continue to hedge with China, and definitely will reap the benefits from more options. But Southeast Asian countries need to be cautious of the uncoordinated competition. It may actually push the Southeast Asian countries into a corner to decide which one to choose. So in my mind, the final configuration of BRI will be determined by China's ability to synergize this division with other countries, not just in Southeast Asia, but also with the global, but also at the global level. So, yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you, Doctor, for maybe finishing slightly ahead of time. Thank you very much. And I think you did a great job. And I like the slogan, BRI as a wake-up call. If that wake-up call did not come, then what would have been the situation? I think this is something we need to discuss. And you spoke in length about the benefits to ASEAN, and I think it's a very beautiful picture that you presented. And also, you did not stop it there, and you posed the challenges for China to deliver. I think that's something this audience will be very interested in finding more details. And you spotted the one critical element, the transparency. I think that's a kind of an accusation against BRI. So if these concerns can be addressed, that's really good. And you also spoke about geopolitical concerns. I mean, in the morning we spoke a lot. And BCI in the future, whether it will be a simple BIM, we have to wait and see whether C will be dropped. And also about competing initiatives, what is the role of Japan in this whole affair, and how their quality, the standards will compete with the China. So we have to wait and see how the outcome. Thank you for a very illuminating lecture. Now I invite my colleague from Pathfinder Foundation, economist by background, Mr. Luxman Siriwardena, to talk about South Asia and the BRI. Over to you, Luxman.
Thank you very much, Jayanath, and I'm very happy to address address you all, because from morning I noticed that one thing, you all are very enthusiastic, intelligent, and posing very very academic and sometimes very political and organic questions. Good. But one thing that, that happened is that after all, everyone spoke, after now, in the morning session, and now in these two professor and that lady doctor speaking, I have nothing to talk. Because South Asia is already in from morning now onwards their presentation and question and answer. Therefore, I in a way difficult because my normal character is not to go through typical prepared speech. But let me just start by saying from prepared speech that, as everybody knows, Silk Road word has come from ancient times, from Rome to China, from an empire time to everything. They have developed taking place. And thanks to this Silk Road phase, Asia became the, one of the most richest or full of treasure. Asia was that, including South Asia. What happened? Today, South Asia is nothing, let's face it, poorest. Among poor are living in South Asia. Let me start with Alphabet alone, otherwise, Bangladesh, India, Myanmar, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, both the countries, are they, can they compare with anything of Southeast Asia? Power distribution, I, before trying to make anything or competing or anything, we have to look inward, center situation inside the country. The same way how the Chinese China was a much worse power distribution than today Sri Lanka or maybe or some of the South Asia. They must develop themselves. They develop not only their physical development, they made reserves to 4 or 5 trillion US dollars of reserves. Then only they started going into OBOR and now going and everything. That's a good lesson, no? Therefore, please remember the people who advise or promote ideas of competing and everything. You've got to be careful, otherwise you would end up like Icarus the bird. You know what I mean. Then, after that, what happened? South Asia went into the current debate due to two reasons. Mainly due to one, that is post-independence following of disastrous economic policies, including Sri Lanka, India. But all were fascinated by the so-called socialist ideology which prevailed during that period. And we went into very poor rates of growth. We were before had emerging wealth, we were trying to redistribute what was not there. That is how we ended up what we are today. Therefore, the 80-90% of the problem is ours. Very wrong, bad economic policy. Even today, without correcting them, only the OBOR cannot compensate or cannot develop our country. That I will come to that, that point again. Then, what happened? Southeast Asia got the best out of everything during the time of first outflow of foreign direct investment from an Asian country, that is Japan in 1980. It was the period where even Singapore, Indonesia, Malaysia, Thai, Korea, Thai, even Hong Kong, all were benefited from that profit. Just like today, in those days, when I was a graduate student in USA, everybody is laughing at me. Why did you come to study economics in USA? You should have gone to Japan. Because they thought they were scared of Japanese investing in USA, buying into the American real estate. Just exactly that's what is happening today to the Chinese. It's the same. All these issues that were raised in the morning, what is the strategy, what is this, are they going to follow us, what is going, what is happening, was never raised, was raised in a different way. In 1980s when the Japanese, Sri Lanka was very much ready in 1978-79, opening up of civil rights. Unfortunately, you know what was done to Sri Lanka, what happened to Sri Lanka, or you can say what was done to Sri Lanka by creating a terrorist movement and therefore destructive effect resulted in being unable to attract Japanese investment. Then, after that happened, once we are here, it's a situation where the so-called leader of the free world, leader of the capitalism, leader of the world is in an economically relative declining trend, that is USA. None of the countries get substantial foreign direct investment from USA. It's very difficult to expect that with the current policy, of course, no. But even earlier it was gradually coming down and now it has come down. Then same with the European investment. I'm not saying zero, but pace of foreign direct investment from those countries to South Asia is declined. Only country which has the capacity of country or the enterprise that has capacity are China. Of course, that capacity is much, much larger than the Japanese in 1980s. That's the, because the economy is so large, the level. Though it is the second largest economy in terms of market GDP, in terms of purchasing power, it is the largest economy, naturally, outflow is. Only thing that what I can say is that South Asia is now much more open than the 80s. In the 80s, only Sri Lanka could have benefited if it had not been for the terrorism that was created. Otherwise, today, compared to 80s, India is more open. Compared to 80s, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Myanmar, Sri Lanka is, of course, very much. Therefore, we are there, we can be benefited. If you have any suspicions about your strategy, security, resource exploitation, I can remember my young days when I was in the university, I was using those words, and still I can see them trying to talk about the neocolonialism, exploitation kind of words. But anyway, it is up to us up to the local government, national government, to introduce safeguards to be in that kind of situation. Therefore, I want to mention something what is missing or less emphasized even by the Chinese OBOR, O-Belt and Road Initiative, has one particular element which is not very much emphasized for whatever reason. That is called policy coordination. I don't understand the word coordination. Being an economist, I understand only the policy reform. For the success of South Asian countries or for that matter, any country, to receive Chinese investment, be a partner of BRI, and to develop beyond the belief of administrator, you've got to have a proper, prudent economic policy. What are the economic policies of the South Asian countries? I don't see any of the South Asian countries. They are not as oligarchic as protectionist as in the 1980s, but still compared to Southeast Asian markets. Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, even Philippines, what is this? These are countries we are keeping very outdated economic policy. Look at the tariff level, look at the protectionism and non-tariff barriers of India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka. Talk about FTAs are there. You introduce free trade in the FTA and then you enter into non-tariff barriers. Therefore, unless you have all that, even Chinese or even the forefathers of Chinese can come and make a country as developed as Singapore, as developed as even Malaysia or any other. Therefore, that element of the BRI needs to be emphasized, needs to be redefined to reflect that market-based economic reform got to be introduced. That's another one thing that I want to say. South Asia cannot actually still, if they can't have a decent political leadership and structure which remain so in a long period of time. Chinese progress, Chinese development model cannot be duplicated by others because we don't have that kind of a disciplined communist party which can command the entire country in a day or two. This is Singapore People's Action Party, am I right? Lee Kuan Yew decided, don't, no more firecrackers, no more. Firecracker industry is gone. I can remember because I was happened to be in Sri Lanka at that time. It's the same. Korea did not develop through so-called democracy, but what was the period of initial development? Of course, my argument, someone might say that I am against democracy, but for third world countries with very corrupt regime, very inconsistent economic policy, you cannot have. Therefore, Belt and Road Initiative can have a positive impact on each and every country, participating or non-party. Like India completely rejects joining the BRI. BRI institutions are utilized by it. Go and invest in the Chinese are allowed to and promoted to go and invest in India. Therefore, any other country need not take any other. Look at the example, everybody. Other than the Americans now, I don't know, even British, French, Germans, Latin Americans, Panama, and they all raise their hand. today have been joined the BRI. Therefore, there is no question about, you know, few petty people making noises, but this BRI has come to say China is a giant player, a major player. Others claim trying to be major player, but China is a major player. Everybody has to face that reality. This morning when the minister spoke, you can understand the most intelligent nation, one of the most intelligent nations, not only in Asia, but in the world, Singapore. See how nicely they address it. We look at opportunity. Slogans doesn't take you or take us anywhere. And then China constitutionalized, entrenched in the constitution of the earth. Therefore, if anyone thinks that this will go away in 5 years, 10 years, it's a great mistake. Because Chinese constitution as a Chinese political system is something entrenched in the society, and that is why I say that the main party, disciplined political party. Therefore, I may not like the Communist Party, I may not like China, but that, or somebody may not like because of historical reasons or conflict, but you can't change it. You can keep shouting. It is better to be accommodated and get ourselves, our policies right. If you have any suspicions of whether Chinese are coming there to spy, it is our, we should protect ourselves. Not banning Chinese either, not say rejecting BR, it's not going to help you. We will realize in 5 to 10 years' time. If I live, I will live. Then, when it comes to, again, I want to emphasize, please, in your policy recommendation, with Institute of South Asian Studies, come up with the document of the conference. What is most crucial aspect to be included is BRI is going to be there. Anyone wants to openly admit and enjoy it, or without admitting it, enjoy in the sense of their economic development, for their poverty stricken people say. But you can't have optimum outcomes, you can't have a real transformational impact unless you have the right economic policy, right institutional reform with corrupt government institutions like in almost all the South Asian countries. Well, people who talked about other problems of beer, man, look at what is inside your rotting institution. If you don't correct it, if you don't reform, including Sri Lanka, I'm referring to, we remember, and corrupt politicians. We have corrupt politicians, we have corrupt leaders. It has been proved. I'm not saying anything that is not proved in Sri Lanka or other countries. I think all of your countries know how corrupt the regime. With such corrupt regime, with not bad institutions, bad economic policy, you cannot maximize economic outcomes of having China in the region. I have 1 minute, actually 1 minute more than, because I will be emphasizing only this sentence. Without doing that, I'm very happy here, but I don't say something. Very learned crowd, don't misunderstand. Non-economists doing that, I can understand. Chinese investment is one thing. If a government goes and borrow from Chinese Exim Bank and get a Chinese company to construct something, it is a different thing. Hamburger port was not built by Chinese government. The government of Sri Lanka went and borrowed money from it is not an investment, borrowed money from the Exim Bank of Japan, China, and got the Chinese VATC to China Harbor Engineering and the top most company to construct. It became an investment. When the government decided to go for a debt equity swap, those who have interest our future in the past or today or expectation might try to say, oh, you are doing something against our country or our people. But that was not the case. It is a bogus, fabricated story to subvert, which should have gone against us, unfortunately. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I think some of us, if we were feeling a little bit asleep, he kept us all awake. It's a very animated conversation, and actually he brought out some very interesting points. And he referred to the BRI to the ancient time as well, the ancient maritime Silk Road. And incidentally, Sri Lanka played a key role, and the whole of ASEAN and South Asia played, most of the countries. So basically in the 21st century, we are actually trying to reconnect ourselves. We are actually trying to reconnect something which we really enjoy. And also he emphasized on the poor economics of South Asia and then the post-independence. So we are still blaming the British even 7 years down the line. And then of course he brought out a nice parallel how ASEAN benefited from the Japanese outgoing or the outflow of FDI in the 1980s and how we actually took the start, but then we could not run the race. We had to stop for whatever the reason. And also he brought out the point what is missing, whether it is policy coordination or what we really need is political reforms. Whether signing a FTA will really transform our economy unless we have robust economic policies. So that's a very clear, very articulated view. And then also he referred to discipline and democracy. So this is a question, I think, bugging our country. So if you take Sri Lanka, 70 years a democratic country, but where are we now with democracy? That is arguable, that can be debated. So what do you really need? Whether you need democracy or development? Or how do you reconcile the two? So that is some argument. And then of course he went on to explain about the Exim Bank loans and the accusations. And thank you, Lakshman. So my final speaker for the session is to talk about another important area. Because you see, when we talk about the Indian Ocean and Pacific Ocean, we tend to forget a very vital area, that is Africa, especially the east coast of Africa, because that is pretty much part of the Indian Ocean, and that is a very important area in the Indian Ocean. I guess it's quite peaceful in that region, so we don't have to really worry too much, whereas we do talk about the contentious areas in the Western Indian Ocean. So I now invite Mr. Johan to share your thoughts on Africa and the BRI.
Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, Murphy said if anything can go wrong with war, O'Toole said that Murphy was an optimist. The reason for that is that our presentation is my topic with my fortune of good luck. It will be on shortly, but not really at this very specific time. Ladies and gentlemen, my predecessors have spoken about the nature of the BRI, the principles driving it, which is an important one from Africa's perspective, given that the principle of inclusivity is a principle that Africa's countries are basing its participation in the BRI part. This is seen as a strategic partnership for investment, for trade, for cooperation, for people-to-people bonds and cultural exchange. The framework of the BRI, ladies and gentlemen, you know as well as I do, it has to do with the land-based Silk Road economic belt, and then on the other hand, the ocean-going maritime Silk Road, which is one that Africa is part and parcel of, the China-India Ocean, African-Mediterranean Sea. The network, ladies and gentlemen, very much dependent on consisting the framework of a network of roads, rail, ports, airports, pipelines, upgraded telecommunication networks. There are five cooperation priorities, of which the policy coordination is an important one, as well as if you have a look at the cooperation mechanism. The policy coordinate, the political cooperation mechanism is an important one in the sense that it consists or enhances the roles of multilateral and bilateral mechanisms which will then enable Africa to participate in the BRI and directly with China. The impact, ladies and gentlemen, the countries involved in this BRI initially, if you have a look at the map that was put out, was Kenya, Djibouti and Egypt. However, given the priority or the principle of inclusivity, the policy coordination and priority and the policy coordination mechanism, Africa is saying we want to be part of the BRI, and we're looking at Africa as a whole. I've spoken to farmers in West Africa, Nigeria, getting excited about the BRI. He said, guys, you're in West Africa, we're looking at East Africa. They say, Johan, you don't understand. So clearly there is in Africa a need, an aspiration to participate in this BRI, or as it's also frequently known in Africa. As far as infrastructure is concerned, ladies and gentlemen, when you look at the FOCAC meeting of 2015, Forum on China-Africa Cooperation, China made available $60 billion to invest in Africa, more than half earmarked for infrastructure and African transportation sector, the major part thereof. Some of the current core projects, ladies and gentlemen, include the upgrading the Mombasa port in Kenya, the Lamu port in Kenya. We're looking at the railway link between Mombasa and Nairobi and from then into the rest of Africa. Power plans to build a pipeline connecting Kenya and Tanzania with the interior, looking at the landlocked countries of Uganda, Ethiopia, Rwanda. And we're back on track, so let me get to where I am. The benefit for Africa, ladies and gentlemen, is obviously that Africa has a massive infrastructure deficit. When I arrived here in Singapore in 2050, we were talking about $93 billion per annum. That in the meantime has gone up, and that is a figure that I've come across from the African Development Bank. We're looking at a figure between $130 and $150 billion. However, in the last year, I came across figures from Nigeria, which they stated Nigeria on its own over the next 30 years is going to need $3 trillion. That's on its own. So either somebody's overstating or somebody's understating. And obviously, they're also looking at technology, etc., expertise from China to participate and get involved in Africa. At a multilateral level, ladies and gentlemen, China said, were you with the African Union in 2015, looking at connecting all 54 countries in Africa with high-speed rails, ports, and roads. The traditional equatorial land bridge, obviously from Lamu to Douala, can then be a good starting point for the BRI in Africa expansion. If we do look at the railway lines in more detail, ladies and gentlemen, I've mentioned from Mombasa going through to Nairobi, quite a couple of roads further on, if you look at Tanzania, in Rwanda,
looking at Ethiopia, defining also roads throughout Africa, West Africa, aligned railway lines. So there is a massive participation, a massive need, and currently, as I said, participation and projects. In terms of ports, ladies and gentlemen, I mentioned Mombasa.
Yeah.
In Ethiopia, we also have, in Kenya, we have Port of Lamu. In Tanzania, we have Dar es Salaam, we have Bagamoyo, going down into Mozambique, and then up the west coast of Africa. Very interesting, the president of Togo stated that Togo intends to be the anchor point in West Africa for the new Silk Road initiative. This is somewhere on the total west coast of Africa. As far as energy is concerned, ladies and gentlemen, we're sitting with a scenario where 620 million people, Africa's 1.2 billion people, do not have access to electricity. There's a requirement for an annual investment of between $43 and $55 billion, which leaves us with a deficit, net deficit of between $35 and $44 billion on an annual basis. And China is getting involved in this, participating in various projects, frequently in the field of renewable energy. In terms of agriculture, ladies and gentlemen, the State Council of China said in 2015 that it has to look at various areas of interest in Africa's agriculture, looking at cooperation in agriculture, forestry, animal husbandry, fisheries, machinery manufacturing, farm produce processing, etc. So one can conclude that for China, Africa's agriculture is a strategic focus for China. Itself is reliant on imports. The challenge, if you look at Africa's agriculture, is that it has the potential to feed the world. We can look at individual countries in Africa that have the potential to feed the whole continent, yet they struggle to feed themselves. So on a net basis, Africa is importing $35 billion of food annually, money which could have been spent much better elsewhere. So from that perspective, we are looking at a scenario where although Africa itself would not be able to feed China, there is interest in contract farming arrangements for key crops, including cotton, tobacco, I might add cassava, just another one, and then the possibilities of investment along agricultural value chains, processing, machinery, and input supply. So as a sector, it is interesting also to note that the infrastructure development that I previously referred to has the potential to help with agriculture. In the rural areas, enhancing food supply, getting better roads in place, getting railways in place, can help the rural farmers get their food, bad foods and produce to markets in the cities, and then also getting input from the cities themselves. In the ICT industry, ladies and gentlemen, we also found that the State Council of China mentioned there the need to grow and develop this sector in Africa, talking about the information Silk Road in general, whereas about bilateral cross-border optical cable networks, transcontinental submarine optical cable projects, and spatial satellite information passageways to expand then the information highway. The implications of the BRI, ladies and gentlemen, in the IT industry is that it is growing currently the number of multinational corporations choosing Africa to locate their production facilities. Also then giving companies the opportunity to close, to develop and close Africa's ICT infrastructure gap. Chinese enterprises have been encouraged to operate and participate in the ICT infrastructure construction. Examples would include ZTE and Huawei, the former planning to leverage 5G and smart city technology to better connect countries across the BRI region.
In terms of manufacturing sector and industrialization, this is a sector in Africa which has been funded to help develop Africa away from its dependence on agriculture to grow and develop the economic growth to a better extent, to become more self-reliant, to increase the number of jobs. And one can see quite an increase in the participation by China in Africa as far as this is concerned. For China, or for Africa rather, China is its largest economic partner. We have over 10,000 Chinese companies in Africa, of which 90% are from the private sector, 33% participating in manufacturing, 12% or they handle 12% of Africa's industrial production. In infrastructure, out of every two companies, one would be a Chinese company participating, making very good margins, I might add, in Africa. Main benefits, obviously, for Africa, ladies and gentlemen, are self-explanatory, job creation, skills development, transfer of knowledge and new technology, and financing and developing infrastructure. Areas that do need to be significantly improved upon include local sourcing, local managers, and for Chinese firms, personal safety, or firms, personal safety and corruption, and for African leaders, looking at language and cultural barriers. If we do look at Ethiopia as the poster boy for manufacturing in Africa, a country which has developed significantly in the past couple of years, making available industrial parks, being a big player, becoming a big player in the field of renewable energy, increasing into the industrialization of agriculture industry, boosting manufacturing, becoming a harbor, you want to call it that, for the textile industry. We have the scenario that Chinese companies have been encouraged to move their low value textile production to Ethiopia. Ethiopia, I've mentioned here as a poster boy, but other East African countries are also taking into this opportunity for themselves. However, unfortunately, ladies and gentlemen, the BRI does not come without its challenges in Africa. Quite a number of political conflict, intra and interstate conflict, political instability, some places domestic disapproval of infrastructure projects, volatile investment environment, geopolitical competition, etc. So it has its challenges and needs, and these challenges, for Africa's sake, needs to be addressed. At this stage, we can realize that I'm a big fan of the BRI as far as Africa is concerned, given the many challenges that Africa faces in the field of infrastructure, transport, energy, etc., looking at the ICT, looking at agriculture, looking at manufacturing and trade. Colleagues, this morning and this afternoon spoke about the AGC, the Asia-Africa Growth Corridor, with India and Japan being the two players, primary players in this. In contrast to the BRI, if you look at the formal language, which only the BRI only touching upon the three that I've mentioned, the AAGC then specifically looks at seven countries on the Eastern African side, looking at Ethiopia, Uganda, Somalia, Kenya, Tanzania, Mozambique, South Africa. And then also the four Indian Ocean islands of Mauritius, Madagascar, Comoros, and Seychelles as the first phase, and with the second phase looking at Gambia, Ghana, and Cote d'Ivoire. In terms of the sectors that it looks at, health, agriculture, disaster management, and skill management, it has more or less the same objectives as the BRI, with the exception that they focus strongly, or as they state, on the autonomy of the different countries involved, and also then on the people side instead of just the fixation on the infrastructure side. The reality is, unfortunately, at this stage of the game, is that As far as Japan's participation is concerned, one has to ask yourself, to what extent we are going to find a scenario that Japan is going to actively participate in IATC, given the fact that in December last year, Prime Minister Abe of Japan announced that the Japanese government plans to cooperate with China on a BRI initiative by financially then supporting private sector partnerships. Does this mean that Japan is not any longer interested in participating in the IATC, or does that mean it's going to be a kind of a yes-yes scenario? I think we will still need to see what that actually been announced. In terms of the necessary conclusions, ladies and gentlemen, we could find a scenario where we find ourselves in a financing conundrum, a funding conundrum, given the fact that a number of these big players are cross-shareholders of banks such as the Asian Development Bank, the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, the New Development Bank of China, or the British Bank rather. So it will be interesting to see how this plays out. China has been, and it has been referred to, blame of, or accused rather, of neo-colonialism. And as I say there, China's involvement in Africa will always be the subject of scrutiny with frequent charges of neo-colonialism. However, my point of view is that to label this as a blanket charge against China would be unfair. Of the 9,000 private sector companies, although they would have the support of the Chinese government, they also have a profit imperative. And I think the Ambassador Belay mentioned this morning, is that Africa has the opportunity to see what it is signing after all. China is the largest source of infrastructure financing in Africa currently. And this does create a certain kind of dependency, which can create vulnerability that would be unhealthy for Africa. So from Africa's perspective, it would be well to reduce this dependency. And this is where the IADC could, can still play a role, to the extent that one could see China allowing its investment partners in Africa to be selective and whose offerings it will tap into. Does the IADC and the BRI, these two initiatives, does it mean that Africa would be to choose? I have a look at South Africa being a South African from this perspective, and the country has all three countries. South Africa has all three countries as major trade partners, and it does not have the luxury of choosing between any of those three. So, and I think that would be the case for most of Africa. Choice as such then is something which we need to look at. What does it mean as far as choice, if there is a choice at all? The inclusivity principle I think is an important one, seeing the fact that it's identified, the BRI is identified, Kenya, Djibouti and Egypt as the main players. China has been quite clear the initiative will be inclusive. It's also adopted the political coordination mechanisms based on bilateral and multilateral agreements. What we also see is a strong momentum from the East, as far as Africa is concerned, not only from China, but everything that is involved. India is a comprehensive investor in Africa, has been for decades, if not centuries. The same goes for China. Africa has to come up with a certain responsibility if it wants to participate and gain all the benefits that it has, which means it needs to make itself attractive for investment, coming up with the necessary incentives and all that. In conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, it's a strategy, BRI, that Africa can and is currently participating and benefiting from. But for me, if one has a look, eventually, the story of the BRI in Africa, for me, is the story of China in Africa. And the main story of infrastructure development in Africa is the story, again, of China in Africa. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. You did stick to the time. Thank you so much. So you brought out the principle of inclusivity, and that's I think one very important area to discuss, whether the BRI is all inclusive or is it for a selected number of countries. And you also mentioned in the beginning the people-to-people contact through BRI. I think that's another way forward, how little connected we are in this region. And you brought out the the way forward, multilateral mechanisms to connect Africa with BRI, and the investment of Chinese investment of $60 billion in developing infrastructure. And you spoke about the deficit in infrastructure and deficit in power generation. I mean, here, I think we have the luxury of switching on a light and open the tap, we get water. I don't know, maybe Singapore it is 100%. But there are regions in the world which is not yet there. So who can help them to overcome that? So that's a great comparison. And also you brought out the point that multinational companies developing ICT infrastructure in anticipation of the future. That's something very great that is. Here again, I think another point that you mentioned, support one of my leaves, 10,000 Chinese companies producing 12% of Africa's production. Now that is, I refer to the don't create a vacuum. If there is a vacuum, somebody will come. So why did not other countries come and invest in Africa? Why was Africa neglected for a long period of time until Chinese companies came and set shop there? And now we say, okay, China has kind of colonized it. And you also expressed the challenges, and you argued the Asia-Africa Growth Corridor as a positive. I mean, whether it can be made a positive, not really to compete against each other, but to benefit Africa in general. That was enough. In the morning also we discussed the same point. And you also mentioned about the Japan joining the BRI. I think that's a development we saw just a few weeks ago. So that will be a huge game changer if that happens. Well, if that happens, I'm sure then many of the other countries who are skeptical of joining BRI will join. And Japan is joining, and there is this mistrust component, but Japan is considered a benign player in most part of the world, and Japan is considered as not having any ulterior motives in most part of the world, so that will be a very plus point. And I think finally you ended up saying Africa need to reduce the dependency. I mean, as a region, Africa should think and need to reduce dependency on the other players. But thank you very much. It was a great presentation. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I think our presenters did very well to stick to the timing. And we'll open the floor. I request Professor Subra Mitra. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. It has been a wonderful panel. And grateful to my colleague, Professor Yonghong, who opened the panel with an enthusiastic, clear, and forceful presentation of the case for the BRI-Myanmar Corridor. What I particularly liked in your talk was your self-reflection towards the end, when you asked, is a corridor built just for now, or is it built to last, like the Great Wall that we saw in Johan's last slide? Now, if a corridor is built to last, like a partnership between two partners, on what condition can it be sustainable? And there you raise the question, which you see reflected in each of the four papers today in this panel. Is a partnership between two unequal partners sustainable in the long run in our time and day? I mean, which is where I would ask a question that has been implicit but has not been asked. And this is a question about trading with China. We had an interview that I saw in Global Times, interview of the new Indian ambassador to China, Mr. Bombale, and he says, he's asked, there's a lot of bitterness between India and China. Is that true? Ambassador says, and he's quite right, there is no bitterness as such. I come from small town India, where you can't buy a firecracker, a pair of shoes, or even a statue of Lord Ganesh, which is not made in China. So there's no problem there. But the problem lies in a deficit of $55 billion that India has built up. Why is the deficit there? The ambassador says, India sells pharmaceuticals and IT products all over the world, but not in China. Why is that? For 20 years, we've been asking for the Chinese market to be open for our pharmaceuticals and IT products and services, to no avail. These are the unstated parameters that go into the BRI. Is it mana from heaven? Is it trade? Is it investment? Is it long-term loan? Second, what kind of consultation is there in the beneficiary countries with the people who are the ultimate stakeholders about the nature of this investment? Third, when you do business with China, who are you doing business with? How do the Chinese make their pricing of products and services? How do they calculate their profits? Is it internal economy? Is it strategy? Now, we are a think tank. It's our job to ask these questions, which are implicit but are never made explicit except within the four walls of our conference rooms. So, I would like Lakshmanji, our economist, to attend this question, or whoever from the panel would like to take them on.
Thank you. I think, what about you, Professor? Would you like to answer this first? Or? Yes. No, it's about China doing business and how do you maintain profits and then. Okay. Lady, would you like to give a shot?
You know, I don't believe any country can subsidize dump any product below cost. For a country, it's not economic. For a company, it's not bad. All these are, you know, fabricated things to protect your economy. Whether it is done by now the Americans, you can see that. And for the last 10, 15 years, all those items were appearing, were imported from South Korea and China, and all of a sudden Trump realized that it was called a kilocop. Similarly, I don't believe, I can't imagine there are Chinese companies, state-owned or private, or anyone who can sell products at kilocop, no economy, no business sense. Anyone with a business sense can believe. I think my colleague from therefore, to the whole, can you sell the product below cost? If somebody is selling it, wait till the.
Thank you, Lakshman. Dr. Gong Xue.
I particularly like your question about who should those actors deal with China in terms of investments. This is the question that a lot of officials from Southeast Asia also raised. I give you an example of Vietnam. China and Vietnam has been talking about this Sino-Vietnamese cross-border economy cooperation committee, and they set up this committee. And they want to, you know, set up a zone as well. But the Vietnamese side, they were confused whether they should talk to the Ministry of Commerce of China or whether they should directly deal with the border province, which is Guangxi province. So for the preference sake, Vietnam prefers to deal with Guangxi province because in terms of economic volume, in terms of the, you know, neighborhood familiarities, Well, she's definitely their best options, but somehow this lack of clear and defined, coordination in China's inter-organizational system creates a lot of confusion. So I don't think it is just a problem you raised about. That's why I pointed out in my slides that China should have a, I'm not saying they should, what I mean is how to make the outsiders understand who they should deal with is one of their priorities to address. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions, please? Oh, so many. One, two.
To me.
Okay, sorry. Please, respond first and then.
Yeah, I think that it's better for me to respond to Dr. Ambassador's questions first, because you actually raised three questions, right? The first one is regarding the partnership establishment. As you think that China and Myanmar may not be equal partners, because China is the second largest economy, while Myanmar is one of the least developed countries in the world. But as a matter of fact, I think that no matter how big the country is, how rich the country is, as in China regard all the nations in the world to be equal. That is one of the key principle of Chinese foreign policy, that regardless of its size or population or wealth scale, that all the countries should be treated equal. So that's why we think that when China and Myanmar establish this economic corridor, China will do it in a fairly equal manner, as China does to other nations, especially maybe in the African countries. So, because at the very many Western scholars ask me the same question. As China is so big, Myanmar is so small, so weak. So is it possible that China can treat Myanmar equally? I told them that, imagine at the very beginning, when China opened its door to the outside world, China was weak. America, Japan, France, Germany, they are powerful. And we welcome these powerful countries to do business with us. So if we talk about Chinese DNA, that the DNA can be summarized as the following 16 keywords. That is peace and cooperation, openness and inclusiveness, mutual learning and mutual benefits. So these 16 keywords can be the Chinese DNA, that is Chinese philosophy. Because you cannot imagine just 40 years ago when China opened its door to the outside. So now American asked me, okay, China is so powerful. I asked them, China is so powerful. You want to do business with Myanmar. You want to do business with Laos. You want to do business with even the poorest country in the world. Why China can't do that? Yeah, no matter what initiatives, what plans China propose, there are some accusations and suspicions. And just remember that China is the only member of the permanent member of the Security Council which hasn't engaged any military activities in the world after this Cold War, after the Cold War, since the early 1990s. Try to imagine. US, Russia, and France, and Britain, they engage in different military activities outside them. China is the only one, not engaged. Just a few days ago, in the Rajaratnam conference, right, I just asked this counter question for all of you. Yeah. And regarding this sustainable cooperation, because Myanmar is our immediate neighbor, and Myanmar now regards that China is a friend indeed. A friend indeed is a friend indeed. Because when Aung San Suu Kyi successfully took power, who can provide the capital, the management and technologies that Myanmar need most to to improve their infrastructure, to change, improve their living standards? Only China. If you ask American people, how much can American provide to Myanmar? Even American official told me that American doesn't have money. Only the private companies have money. Right. So this is sustainable. We regard Myanmar as one of the immediate neighbor which needs China, and we trust each other. So this cooperation can be permanent and sustainable based on this equal treatment. And this is okay. The third question may be, why China is not open to India's pharmacy and IT companies? There are large trade deficit between China and India. Yes, it's true that. But if we think things in the opposite position, if one country intends to increase its trade with another country, the country's enterprises should be should have lower costs and higher technology and better competition, right? So I always said that, okay, we work on India's participation in ASEAN. Let China and India have a fair play in ASEAN or in South Asia, because as rising powers, both China and India should shoulder more responsibilities to the neighboring countries in helping the neighboring countries to develop instead of something else, right?
Okay. Thank you. I think two questions. We'll take three at a time. One, two, three. Over there. And then the Deputy High Commissioner.
My name is Jayesh. I represent CIIO here. I have two points. One is about an experience of from you, the chair. Do you have a trade deficit from between Sri Lanka and China? Maybe yes or no. I would like to know a bit more about that. That's point one. Point number two, with CII, you have represent most of the Indian industries across in India and across the globe as well. The feedback that we get, especially when they work in China, we have an office in Shanghai as well, is they find it pretty tough to get inroads, especially on few sectors, IT, like what you mentioned, the IT, the pharma, and the others. So like what Prof said, let's work in ASEAN is one angle that you can mention, but look at the other side of it. Why is that we can't work inroads in China, whereas the Chinese companies can work inroads in India? They can come set up their shops, work in tier 2, tier 3 cities in India, manufacture mobiles, and they are the number one mobile manufacturers in India. India is consuming it, and the trade deficit is extremely high. When we do, we have trade deficits with other countries, we try matching it up, the other countries also help us. Why is this, the trade mismatch happening over there, which is a point of concern from the Indian side as well? And especially there are a few sectors, pharma being the highest, because there are many companies, the Indian companies based in Singapore, who actually looks after the region. They say we are successfully operating in the region, APAC also, except China, which they have very huge concerns about. And maybe I want Prof to explain a bit more. You said that India and China work a bit more in ASEAN together in certain sectors. So I wanted a bit more thoughts from you on this. Thank you.
Thank you. I have a small clarification to ask from Professor Dai. You mentioned about BCIM, and you also mentioned about China-Myanmar Economic Corridor, and that is getting extended into Bangladesh later. You spoke about how Dhaka will be connected with this corridor. Just tell me how you are planning to do it. Do you want to connect Dhaka via Narayanganj, Chittagong, and into Myanmar? Or you want to connect it with Dhaka, then Sylhet, then Shillong, Manipur, and towards Mandalay? How you want to do that? Second thing, you mentioned about the Italian project, Japanese project, Thai projects in Myanmar, which is a very good thing. but and I thank Professor Bo for that she mentioned about the Indian projects over there. You didn't mention about the other multimodal project and what synergy it can have with ECIM and with China-Myanmar Industrial Corridor. Because when the think tanks speak with each other, that time they mentioned about the synergy. But your presentation, I found it lacking. So I thought I will ask you about the synergy and how you want to connect Dhaka with these two different initiatives. Thank you.
Thank you. We go for the third question as well.
Thank you, Chair. My name is Teng Sap from the ASEAN Study Center. I'm from Thailand also, but I was surprised to hear mentioning of Italian role in the Dai project in Myanmar. Actually, it's only the name. Ito Thai had no Italian connection. It's just a Thai company name. And by the way, the Dai project already been taken over from Ito Thai by the Myanmar government and the Thai government. So now, no Italian role in the Dai project. I want to comment briefly on Professor Dai. Although China did not undertake any foreign military activity, but you already built a new naval facility in Djibouti. And you already built the Great Wall Sand artificial islands, disputed feature in South China Sea. I think that's a major military threat from the past that China never took. Actually, I have a question for Mr. Burger. I know very little about Chinese investment in Africa, but what we read in the international media is mostly negative outcome of the Chinese infrastructure project in Africa. From your perspective, could you tell us one or two major success in the Chinese investment in infrastructure in Africa?
I think about the budget deficit, I think Lakshman may know. About Sri Lanka, China budget deficit? Sorry, the trade deficit.
I think our favorable trade deficit comes from US Sri Lanka trade is inferior. If our trade deficit with Japan is negative, China is negative. Individual country balance of trade is not a criteria. Overall balance of in economy, in international trade, individual country, no one should try to balance it, each and every country or trade. It doesn't matter. As long as you have the overall balance. That is very first thing. Even if the overall balance is negative, that is trade balance, trade in goods balance. There are other ways that the overall balance of trade can be equalized, can be balanced. You know, therefore, for everyone, that I am trying to say is that don't worry about individual current country balance. If Sri Lanka's balance is now, the trade balance is worse with China, why say, for example, improving with China, America or some other country means our consumers are more conscious about what is the most economical place to import. Indian cars are ample in Sri Lanka. Our balance of trade is very bad in that sense. Careful. That means consumers find a better product at a lower price, lower quality. Well, quality may be lower, but that is what I want. You know, these kind of arguments are not the way to world's problem. Those are good for Trump, not for normal people.
Okay, thank you very for your good questions. Okay, actually three questions. First is about how can Myanmar, how can China, Myanmar, and Bangladesh cooperate in establishing these highways or this train or these railways from Kaohsiung to Dhaka? Because it is my personal view to think that this CMEC, China-Myanmar Economic Corridor, can be undertaken in two phases. The first phase is according to the national the official plan between China and Myanmar. And because what China intends to do is that to integrate China's BRI projects to Myanmar's domestic national agenda of development. So for your question, maybe we can discuss, we can consult to do some field investigation before we can make any policy advices for that. The second question is about regarding, of course, I know that this Dawei Special Economic Zone, there are some Thailand companies and the Italian companies are involved in this. And I don't mean that Italian government is engaging in this. Only Italian companies now is taken over by Myanmar government. So because so far as I know, Myanmar government has paid special attention to this Dawei economic zone maybe in the next few years. So regarding the third question, Djibouti military base, so which actually made sensational news, of course, the international media, because they think that China, as the second largest economy and the largest trader of the tangible trader, China can't have such overseas facilities to secure the overseas interests of Chinese companies. I think it's unfair for China because as we know that the largest economy, US have so many military and naval bases across the world and so many facilities. China holds has won the first Djibouti base, so that's made sensational news. I think that China can have such and maybe more. Because we are the second largest economy, we are the largest trader company. We have so much international overseas interest to be protected, and there is vacancies. Who can secure the safety of the commercial fleets traveling in the Indian Ocean, as Admiral said that? Because China shoulder the responsibility. This is a kind of public goods that China can provide to the world based on its three advantages: capital advantage, technology advantage, and management. As Singapore has contributor, one of the greatest contributor to this regional cooperation and the international cooperation, which I said that Singapore is very, even though size is small, but contribution is big.
Thank you, John, for your remarks and final thoughts, please.
Two examples that come up in terms of infrastructure, the SGR from Mombasa to Nairobi, and then the electric train from Addis to Djibouti. I think if we go further, we can come across quite a number. However, on the other side, one can also find quite a couple of instances that weren't working as well, and where there have been failures. It all depends on what perspective you're looking at and whose standards you're measuring. But I hope I've answered your question.
I think my answer may not directly as in response to Dr. Thompson's, but what I understand your question is how, maybe alluding to the previous question, how sustainable or Chinese investments are. Well, indeed, I think there are a lot of criticisms and they really exist. What I see is the positive sides, they are emerging. People may need to take a closer look. So for the past decade, I think since 2007, the Chinese government has been cooperating with International Financial Center in terms of incorporating this corporate social responsibility idea. And they also cooperate with the Swedish government. And you can find details in this Sino-Swedish corporate social responsibility website. And in 2013, the Chinese banks, they issued the green credit lending, which means they have different categories for those companies who borrow the money with conditions. So for those companies who, conducted something really, really, actively, they may face some punishments. However, on the other hand, the Chinese investments, they are also changing from the G2G now more inclined to PPP. I take you an example in Malaysia, the Kuantan Industrial Port. There's a Chinese and Malaysian consortium in charge of the steel production. So in the contract signed, in 2012, if I'm not wrong, the contract says the Chinese companies will move will use the Chinese technicians, some of the Chinese workers, but after 3 years of the projects done, they are going to provide 3,000 employment opportunities for the Kuantan Industrial Park. So this is these changes, they need people to take a closer look. But there's also one more problem is China has different understanding of governance, of sustainability. Like previously, the Chinese companies think, okay, paying tax, creating a low, local employment rate is considered as corporate social responsibility, while they kind of ignore the environmental protection. But now they're changing. The question is, to what extent they can meet the satisfaction of the international society, and to what extent it can cooperate with the stakeholders that includes international NGOs, etc. But I think the Chinese companies and also the Chinese government, they're on the learning curve. Yes, thank you.
Thank you. I'm afraid time is over, and I really like to congratulate my panel. You did a wonderful job. You brought many perspectives to the table, and we had a very free and fair and very highly academic discussion. Thank you very much. May I kindly request you again to give them a round of applause. And also, thank you, ISAS, for creating this event. And I also take this opportunity to wish you a spring festival. Gong Xue Fa Kai. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Colombage. We would now like to invite Dr. Colombage to present our tokens of appreciation to our distinguished speakers. First, Professor Dai Yonghong. Next, Dr. Gong Xue.